Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Profiling the Fraudster, Removing the Mask to Prevent and Detect Fraud, Wiley Corporate F&A, by Simon Padgett, narrated by Barry Abrams. Publisher's note, this audiobook has bonus material. Please contact whomever you purchased this audiobook from to request the material. All figures referenced in this audiobook can be found in the bonus material. Preface. The typical organization loses 5% of its annual revenue to fraud. Applied to the estimated 2011 gross world product, this figure translates to a potential total fraud loss of more than $3.5 trillion worldwide, according to the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners, ACFE, report to the nation's 2012. So, put in context, fraud is material. Profiling is a part of everyday life for all of us, using previous experiences to determine how we get through the day's activities. Indeed, when we approach winter months, we know that we need warmer clothing. Why? Because last winter told us so. When we drive through an intersection or the stoplight turns red, we know exactly what to do or how to react to the event because we have done it so many times before. More to the point, we can identify the cold of winter and the challenges we face while driving because we have seen the patterns on numerous occasions before, and our brains have analyzed the information at that time, stored the patterns of data, and drawn on the stored memory to deal with the current event. Then consider your favorite sport and trying to work out who will win. In the same way that we recall previous events, we also recall previous history of individual sports teams and individuals. Soccer players of a certain age may be in their peak. Rugby players from a certain continent may win more games, and marathon runners from certain African countries are always likely to run the fastest times. This is everyday profiling of individuals based on previous experiences. If this process works in dealing with the characteristics of day-to-day activities and people we come into contact with, then why is this process of profiling not more prevalent in the fight against fraud? It can be seen that many forensic investigations do not have a formal process for either drawing from or contributing to fraud type and fraudster profiling. Fraud profiling has the potential to serve as an aid to fraud investigations. Valuable data and information on offenders and fraud situations and scenarios is not being used as much as it should or could be by investigators in the identification of fraud in the workplace. Occupational fraud, or white-collar crime, reflects a high rate of incidence and a relatively low rate of detection, making it one of the significant crime challenges of the 21st century. Fraud risk can be more effectively managed by integration and use of previous knowledge concerning the individual, the situational environment, and motivations driving fraud offenders. Examination of empirical research on fraud types and fraud offenders yields common characteristics, such as the fact that the average fraudster, statistically, is male, is married with a degree, and has a professional relationship, usually by means of employment with the victim organization. The fraudster is most likely to work in the accounting, finance, or procurement department, those being the gatekeeper elements of the business process, and not within the internal audit department. Currently, he or she is more likely to be working for a financial services organization, according to the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners and its 2012 Report to the Nations on Occupational Fraud and Abuse. Research has revealed many types of fraud offender and the circumstances in which fraud is committed. Much of this research tells us that the fraudster is the opportunistic offender with no criminal record, who, out of greed, abuses a position of financial trust to commit a fraud alone or with few accomplices. An interesting finding is the fact that most fraud offenders find complex methodologies to carry out and also to hide their crimes. This has implications for prevention strategies, in so much as the traditional barriers to fraud of internal accounting controls and employment screening are no longer sufficient on their own. So, if profiling techniques are to be added to the fraud investigator's toolbox, then we must first ask, and more important, answer some questions. How does profiling assist and add value to investigations? What key aspects of an offender profile should be included in the profiling? And are such details as marital status, age, and race really necessary, as well as fraudster background, skill, and professional qualifications? Would it be beneficial to include in such profiling the characteristics of the fraud scheme or scenario itself and the situation that lends itself to the fraud? Furthermore, should the type of victim organization be analyzed, and should this be further drilled down into as to which departments and divisions are more prone to fraud attack? Many surveys tell us that 80 to 85% of fraud is committed by insiders. Surely, if we knew from which departments the fraudsters emanate, or possibly more important, which vulnerable departments they try to be recruited in, then this could be a focal area for both proactive fraud risk management and reactive investigation. We all too often focus on the control environment, and quite often human beings are fundamental to that control environment, or at least key elements of it. Human beings are the weakest link. How strong is the control in a segregation of duties if the employees in the process exhibit characteristics that place their honesty and integrity in doubt? Surely, if the human element of the control environment is not considered, then such controls are weak or even non-existent. Profiling of these employees is fundamental to an effective control environment. There is no doubt, however, that a full understanding of what fraud is and which measures are best suited to combating the fraud disease is absolutely necessary before we can start to profile the fraudster or his actions. We have to face the fact that fraud cannot be prevented. Internal controls and security systems reduce the risk, but there are no guarantees, and the track record of prevention and detection is actually not great. Humans can be ingenious and their behavior unpredictable. Some are desperate. Many are merely risk takers. Most are both. Some employees may have a lot more devious entrepreneurial spirit than we may have imagined. If fraud is committed by trusted employees who know the system, then it is quite likely that they also know how to bypass these controls, and therefore, something more is required in the preventive and detective fight. Fraud profiling is the process of identifying the characteristics that the fraudster and his fraud would present or be visualized if that fraud were to happen in your organization. If you know what it looks like, you can identify or recognize it and catch it when it happens. If you catch it when it happens, it will make the next person think twice about committing fraud and will leave investigators with key indicators of the behavioral or situational patterns or footprints for the future. Interestingly, as is the case at the time of writing, in periods of economic slowdown or recession, the likelihood of employee fraud increases. Apart from the increase in financial need, there is also increased psychological pressure on employees. Employees tend to not only be under greater personal financial stress currently, but may also be under greater personal insecurity about their future in the organization. When close colleagues are laid off, fear and insecurity prevail psychologically. This brings about a further dimension to the profiling scenario, the fact that the economic environment should be included as a constituent part of profiling fraudsters. Put simply, human beings in a deprived part of a city, in a country going through economic slowdown, might be more apt to commit fraud than those earning good salaries in a country that is booming or bypassing recession. The economic environment, therefore, also needs to be included in any profiling methodology. In summary, fraud happens. It happens in any organization that has money or assets, irrespective of profitability. Quite often, it is a cause of an organization not being profitable. The fraudster is internal. Remember, 80 to 85% of fraud is committed by persons inside the organization, by our colleagues who are more often than not at a senior level and to whom we report and upon whom we rely to safeguard the assets of our business. We have to adopt the attitude that the fraudster is within our organization, and therefore it is only prudent that we alter the paradigm and expect that fraud will happen and adopt a preventive strategy. In order to be ahead of the curve, that strategy has to include the relatively new dimension of profiling. In order to identify anything, you have to know what it looks like. If you don't know what it looks like, you may walk right past it without recognizing it. There are an infinite number of characteristics of fraud offenders and fraud types or scenarios, and there are an infinite variety of industries, business structures, departments, accounting systems, and so on. Like attempts to prevent fraud, there is no guarantee that a detection strategy will work all the time and identify every fraud. But research indicates that most occupational fraud is not sophisticated and generally not well concealed. All that is required is to identify what it would look like, and it will more than likely be found. Profiling is not intended to provide an absolute guarantee of fraud detection, but an incremental improvement in the odds against your business becoming a victim of fraud. So, if we can profile the following footprints attributable to the act of fraud, then we have a pretty good coverage of all likely characteristics, providing us with the greatest chance of recognizing the fraudster and the fraud act. The fraudster's behavioral indicators. The environment in which the fraud occurs, to include victim organization type and sector, victim department, fraudster's position and department, geographical location, economic situation. Fraud type characteristics. Fraud methodology or modus operandi. Fraud motivators. Characteristics of consequences or the impact of fraud. The process of profiling has to be made simple and understandable, yet it should be rigorous and comprehensive. Its objective is the development of a set of detection controls that will identify the characteristics of a fraudster or patterns that fraud would present if it were to occur in your business. This book examines how profiling occupational fraudsters and their actions and characteristics can help in the proactive fight to reduce fraud risk in the organizational workplace, and it explains how to prepare a fraud profiling methodology for your organization. This book is a must-have valuable resource in your anti-fraud library. Profiling the Fraudster, Removing the Mask to Prevent and Detect Fraud features detailed analysis and breakdown of profiling and its relevance in occupational fraud-fighting methodologies. Clear insights into the mind of the fraudulent employee. Observations, analysis, and conclusions to guide listeners through prevention and detection strategies using profiling. Integrated extracts from professional surveys, including the ACFE's Report to the Nations on Occupational Fraud and Abuse, revealing statistics on cost, prevalence, patterns of fraud and fraud prevention, and what it all means. A step-by-step approach to using profiling and investigative psychology to manage fraud risk. Designing fraud profiling methodologies to suit your organization. Part 1. Occupational Fraud and Corruption. Chapter 1. Introduction to Occupational Fraud and Corruption and Recent Trends. When I started writing this book, I considered jumping in at the deep end and commenced rapidly making notes of the various approaches to profiling by compiling a list, based on my 20 or so years of experience in the fraud investigation field, of exactly what, when profiled, would be of use to the fraud investigator. Yes, there is the behavior of the convicted fraudster to understand, as well as his modus operandi, but what about which industry type or department he is likely to work in, his likely position within the organization, the likely geographical location, economic environment, and personal circumstances. We also need to understand the profile of the higher-risk victim organizations and their characteristics. Anyway, I quickly realized that to fully understand the subject of profiling, we first need to have a fairly good grounding in or understanding of the subject of fraud and corruption, what it is, and how it affects organizations and all of us who are associated with those organizations. It is also, possibly even more so, very important to understand the types of controls that are designed, put in place, and often bypassed to enable us to manage fraud risk in organizations. After all, fraud is perpetrated by human beings as a reaction to opportunities created by weak safeguarding processes. Profiling is a further anti-fraud methodology to add to the stable, and it does require an understanding of how and where in the corporate environment it would best sit. After all, you would not bring in a new team member without first ensuring a good fit, or put a new thoroughbred into a stable to share with other horses without first having an understanding of those neighbors and what makes them kick. So, let's have a look at the world of fraud and corruption, and how, since time immemorial, we appear to be failing in our attempts to manage fraud risk in the organizational environment. Deception through breaching trust. The term fraud has come to encompass many forms of misconduct. Although the legal definition of fraud is very specific, for most people like you and me, anti-fraud professionals, regulators, the media, and the general public alike, the common use of the word is much broader and generally covers any attempt to deceive another party to gain a benefit. Expense fraud, forgery, counterfeiting, identity theft, theft of inventory by employees, manipulated financial statements, insider trading, Ponzi schemes, mortgage fraud. The range of possible fraud schemes is actually endless, but at their core, all involve a violation of trust. It is this violation that, perhaps even more than the resulting financial loss, makes such crimes so harmful. For businesses to operate and for commerce to flow freely, organizations must entrust their employees with resources and responsibilities. So, when an employee defrauds his or her employer, the fallout is often especially harsh. The focus of this book is occupational fraud schemes in which an employee abuses the trust placed upon him or her by an employer for personal gain. The formal definition of occupational fraud, taken from the Association of Certified Fraud Examiners, ACFE, website, http://www.acfe.com/fraud-101.aspx, is the use of one's occupation for personal enrichment through the deliberate misuse or misapplication of the employing organization's resources or assets. While this occupational fraud category is but one facet of the vast overall fraud universe, fraud in the workplace is huge and covers a wide range of employee misconduct. It is without doubt a material threat faced by all organizations and their employees worldwide. Global trends in occupational fraud. The Association of Certified Fraud Examiners, ACFE, a leading professional body of fraud examiners, has undertaken extensive research into the costs and trends relating to occupational fraud schemes. The findings of the ACFE's initial research efforts were released in 1996 in the first Report to the Nations on Occupational Fraud and Abuse, with subsequent reports released in 2002, 2004, 2006, 2008, and 2010. The ACFE's 2012 Report to the Nations on Occupational Fraud and Abuse, now carried out every 2 years, provides an analysis of 1,388 fraud cases investigated worldwide by qualified fraud examiners and continues a tradition of shedding light on trends in the characteristics of fraudsters, the schemes they perpetrate, and the organizations being victimized. The ACFE findings truly reflect global trends in occupational fraud and abuse and are invaluable in keeping us abreast of the fraud disease. The goals of these reports have been to summarize the opinions of experts on the percentage of organizational revenue lost to all forms of occupational fraud and abuse, categorize the ways in which occupational fraud and abuse occur, examine the characteristics of the employees who commit occupational fraud and abuse, determine what kinds of organizations are victims of occupational fraud and abuse. Each version of the report has been based on detailed information about fraud cases investigated by certified fraud examiners, CFEs. Each new edition expands and modifies the analysis contained in the previous reports to reflect current issues and enhance the quality of the data that is reported. This evolution has allowed the release of increasingly meaningful information from the experiences of CFEs and the frauds that they encounter. Fraud, like many other crimes, can be explained by the existence of the following four key drivers. 1. A supply of motivated, pressurized, or incentivized offenders. 2. The absence of capable guardians and policing, or weakness in control systems, opening up an opportunity. 3. Rationalization in the fraudster's mind, bringing about justification for his actions and exploiting the opportunity to satisfy the motivation. 4. The availability of suitable victim organizations. The motivation, pressure, or incentive to defraud may be as simple as financial need or greed, or anything from unrealistic deadlines and performance goals to personal vices such as gambling or drugs. The opportunity to commit and conceal fraud is really the only element over which an organization has significant control. The opportunity is an open door to solving a non-shareable problem by violating a position of trust and is generally provided through weaknesses in the internal controls. Some examples of weak internal controls include, but are by no means limited to, absent or inadequate procedures surrounding the following: supervision and review, segregation of duties, management approval and delegation of authority, system controls. Rationalization is a crucial component because most people need to reconcile their behavior with the commonly accepted notions of decency and trust. Some examples of justifications for their actions given by fraudsters I have met include the following. I really need this money, and I'll put it back when I get my salary at the month's end. I'd rather have the company on my back than the tax people. Everyone else is doing it. I just can't afford to lose everything I have worked for, my home, my car, everything. The availability of a suitable victim organization is an easy one. It is more often than not the fraudster's employer, with whom he has built up a relationship of trust, quite often over many years. The ACFE 2012 Report to the Nations on Occupational Fraud and Abuse analyzes statistics from fraud cases investigated worldwide to gain an understanding of the characteristics of fraudsters, their schemes, and the types of organizations being targeted. Throughout the report, the statistics include comparison charts showing several years of data, which highlight the consistency of findings over time. This uniformity is among the most notable of observations from the ongoing research and indicates that the findings truly reflect global trends in occupational fraud and abuse, and that the ACFE statistics represent an important core base for profiling in any organization. The cost of occupational fraud and corruption. Determining the full cost of occupational fraud is an important part of understanding the depth of and motivation for the fraud problem. News reports provide visibility to the largest cases, and most of us have heard stories of employees who have brazenly stolen from their employers. Even so, fraud is all too often treated as an anomaly in the business process, rather than a common example of the risk faced by all organizations. Unfortunately, obtaining a comprehensive or exact measure of the financial impact of fraud and corruption on organizations is challenging, if not impossible. Because fraud inherently involves efforts of concealment, many fraud cases will never be detected, and of those that are, the full amount of losses might never be determined or reported. Consequently, any attempt to quantify the extent of all occupational fraud losses will be, at best, an estimate. As part of the ACFE's research in its report to the nations, each CFE who participated in the survey was asked to provide his or her best assessment of the percentage of annual revenues that the typical organization loses to fraud. The median response indicates that organizations lose an estimated 5% of their revenues to fraud each year. To illustrate the magnitude of this estimate, applying the percentage to the 2011 estimated gross world product of $70.28 trillion results in a projected global total fraud loss of more than $3.5 trillion. It is imperative to note that this estimate is based on the collective opinion of anti-fraud experts rather than on specific data or factual observations, and should thus not be interpreted as a literal calculation or extrapolation of the exact and total worldwide cost of fraud against organizations. Even with that caveat, however, the approximation provided by more than 1,000 CFEs from all over the world, with a median 11 years of experience as professionals who have a first-hand view of the fight against fraud, may well be the most reliable measure of the cost of occupational fraud available, and certainly emphasizes the undeniable and extensive threat posed by these crimes. Of the 1,388 individual fraud cases reported in the ACFB survey, 1,379 included information about the total dollar amount lost to fraud, as shown in Figure 1.1. Individuals commit occupational fraud, costing businesses considerable sums of money. Worldwide, a potential global fraud loss of more than $3.5 trillion, according to the ACFE report. The median loss, the report states, was $140,000. More than one-fifth of the frauds involved losses of at least $1 million, and the frauds lasted a median of 18 months before being detected. It can be seen that any methodology that can be used to improve fraud risk management must be seriously considered. Types of occupational fraud. The top three classifications or means of committing occupational fraud are corruption, asset misappropriation, and fraudulent financial statements, as depicted in Figure 1.2. Within each classification is a myriad of types and schemes that need to be understood when considering methodology profiling. As indicated in Figure 1.3, asset misappropriation is by far the most frequent form of occupational fraud, comprising 87% of the cases reported. It was also the least costly form of fraud, with a median loss of $120,000. At the lower end of the frequency spectrum are cases involving financial statement fraud. Financial statement fraud was, however, by far the most costly form of occupational fraud. Financial statement fraud schemes made up just 8% of the cases in the ACFE study, but caused the greatest median loss at $1 million. Corruption schemes fell in the middle, occurring in just over one-third of reported cases and causing a median loss of $250,000, with asset misappropriation having the lowest median loss, as depicted in Figure 1.4. High-level or owner or executive perpetrators cause the greatest fraud loss to their organizations in terms of monetary value rather than quantities of frauds. This is particularly shocking considering that the tone at the top is considered to be a fundamental constituent part of a sound anti-fraud program. In actual fact, frauds committed by owners or executives were more than three times as costly as frauds committed by managers and more than nine times as costly as other employee fraud, according to the ACFE. Executive-level fraud also took much longer to detect. The most common executive-level fraud, according to the survey, is corruption, 54% of cases, followed by fraudulent invoicing schemes, 33%, expense reimbursement fraud, 21%, and fraudulent financial statements, 21%. Other schemes include payroll fraud, check tampering, and cash theft. Early fraud. Business has been around for thousands of years, and the way it is run and sometimes abused can be embedded deep in the culture. Occupational fraud was defined by American criminologist Edwin H. Sutherland, 1883 to 1950, as a crime that involves a betrayal of trust implied in the holding of an office or other position of trust. Sutherland used the term white-collar crime, casting doubt on the idea that poverty breeds crime. Sutherland argued in White-Collar Crime that members of society occupying positions of privilege and status were just as likely to commit crime as those from lower classes. Sutherland's work, it could be argued, reflects some of the earliest studies on profiling criminals. It can be contended that rationalization of occupational crime comes from its low visibility, occurring under cover of employment, with victims often suffering without meeting perpetrators, resulting in the indirect nature of the act giving the appearance that it is victimless. Research shows, however, that occupational fraudsters display criminal thinking that parallels street-level offenders with similar behavioral traits that serve as risk factors. Generally, fraudsters live well-ordered lives and are well-respected in their communities and at work. They commit fraud in their workplace to fulfill a financial need when there is an opportunity to do so and when they can rationalize their deed. Cressy's Fraud Triangle, 1953. Trusted, well-paid employees risk their careers by stealing from their employers due to financial difficulties, lifestyle maintenance, anger, low loyalty, revenge, and boredom. KPMG, 2011. Occupational fraud is costlier than other crimes and affects more people. ACFE, Report to the Nations, 2012. It relies on deceit and concealment and often employs sophisticated technology. Further to motive and opportunity, techniques of neutralization enable individuals to violate normative and ethical standards. Coleman, 2002. For example, by justifying theft as borrowing, criminal activities may be deemed to be a normal way of stealing or achieving business targets. Trying to prove that a fraudster intends to permanently deprive an organization can be difficult when the fraudster has claimed that he intends to repay the amount or has already done so. Offenders may justify their behavior by claiming that they are not really hurting anyone, that everyone else is doing it, or that the activities may have been carried out that way for many years. This may be a reflection on their culture or background. The ACFE estimates that some $3.5 trillion of fraud is happening worldwide. The National Fraud Authority in the United Kingdom publishes its annual fraud indicator every year, which estimates that fraud in 2011 was costing the UK economy over £38 billion a year, equating to a shocking £765 per adult per year. This figure includes estimated undetected losses. In the Compliance Reporter article, UK Fraud at Record Level, 2012, KPMG reported the actual 2011 UK fraud to be £3.5 billion. The 2011 Fraud Track report, released by accountancy firm BDO, revealed a significant increase in both the number and value of reported frauds in the United Kingdom in the previous year to the highest level of fraud since the report began in 2003. In 2010, there were 372 cases of reported fraud with an average value of £3.7 million each. This had risen to 413 cases with an average of £5 million each. The fight against fraud. The nature and threat of occupational fraud is universal, according to the ACFE. Although the research in its 2012 Report to the Nations noted some regional differences in the methods used to commit fraud, as well as organizational approaches to preventing and detecting it, many trends and characteristics are similar regardless of where the fraud occurred. Whereas this may make writing a textbook on how to deal with fraud a little easier, in that much of the approach may take a standardized approach, this is certainly not the case when we start to consider profiling. Profiling the human being cannot be a standard process with a one-size-fits-all solution. Each human being has unique characteristics and behavioral attributes, thereby giving a unique angle to what may be described as universal fraud. Providing individuals with a means to report suspicious activity is a critical part of any anti-fraud program. Fraud reporting mechanisms, such as communication channels and whistleblowing hotlines, should be set up to receive tips from both internal and external sources and should ideally be externally managed, should offer anonymity and toll-free calling, and should allow confidentiality. Management should actively encourage employees to report suspicious activity, offering a reporting process free of reprisals and with the maximum protection for the whistleblower. In many jurisdictions, this protection comes through the legal system with whistleblower protection embedded in local law. Interestingly, where I have worked on introducing whistleblowing mechanisms in organizations in jurisdictions where there is no legal protection for whistleblowers, I strongly advise that the organization's CEO or chairman state in his launch address, as well as in his preamble in the whistleblowing policy, that he personally guarantees the protection of whistleblowers and that their actions will not be detrimental to them in any way, irrespective of legal protection or its absence. External audits should not be relied on as an organization's primary fraud detection method, says the ACFE. Such audits were the most commonly implemented control in the study. However, they detected only 3% of the frauds reported, and they ranked poorly in limiting fraud losses. While external audits serve an important purpose and can have a strong preventive effect on potential fraud, their usefulness as a means of uncovering fraud is limited. Both internal and external auditors, however, have access to and are therefore crucial to the collection and analysis of the information and data required to set up a profiling mechanism in the organization. Targeted fraud awareness and sensitization training for employees and managers is a critical component of an effective anti-fraud program and is a proven method of preventing and detecting fraud. Not only are employee tips the most common way occupational fraud is detected, but the research shows that organizations that have anti-fraud training programs for employees, managers, and executives experience lower losses and shorter fraud durations than organizations that do not have such programs in place. At a minimum, staff members should be sensitized as to what fraud actually is, what actions constitute fraud, how fraud harms everyone in the organization, and how to report suspected fraudulent activity. Research continues to show that small businesses are particularly vulnerable to fraud. These organizations typically have fewer resources than their large counterparts, which often translates to fewer and less effective anti-fraud controls. In addition, because smaller businesses have fewer resources, the losses they experience tend to have a greater impact than they would in larger organizations. Managers and owners of small businesses should focus their anti-fraud efforts on the most cost-effective control mechanisms, such as hotlines, employee training, and setting a proper ethical tone at the top and within the organization. Additionally, assessing the specific fraud schemes that pose the greatest threat to the business can help identify those areas that merit additional investment in targeted anti-fraud controls. The fraud risk assessment process is invaluable in determining fraud risk exposure and is a fundamental element of fraud profiling. Profiling as a solution. In terms of profiling, most fraudsters exhibit behavioral traits that can serve as warning signs of their actions. These red flags, such as living beyond one's means or exhibiting excessive territorial control issues, generally will not be identified by traditional internal controls that are designed to focus on the organization's processes rather than human behavior. Managers, employees, and auditors should be educated through the training and sensitization programs on these common behavioral patterns and encouraged to consider them, particularly when noted in tandem with other anomalies, to help identify patterns that might indicate fraudulent activity. The cost of occupational fraud, both financially and possibly more important to an organization's reputation, can be acutely damaging. With nearly half of victim organizations unable to recover their losses, proactive measures to prevent fraud are critical. Management should continually assess the organization's specific fraud risks and evaluate its fraud protection programs in light of those risks. Profiling of the fraudster and his modus operandi will be a valuable addition to the fraud fighter's toolkit. The fact that the level of reported fraud is up is worrying, but not at all surprising. When the economic climate is difficult, there is even more focus on the bottom line and driving out unnecessary costs, so fraud is more likely to be uncovered. Companies should have a proactive approach to fraud protection to avoid increases in the level of fraud. Organizations need to be taking a profit and loss approach to fraud risk. If companies continue to take a reactive approach to preventing fraud, it will continue to rise year after year. You cannot design all fraud risk out of a business, but you can put tripwires in place. Chapter 2. Types of Occupational Fraud and Corruption. Most occupational fraud and corruption schemes use one or more of the following embedded techniques: abuse of power, embezzlement, misuse of business time, computer fraud, stock and equipment pilferage, and expense abuse. Abuse of power. This scheme involves making inappropriate financial decisions to benefit the employee rather than the organization. For example, the employee signs contracts with more expensive outside vendors and receives a kickback in return. Kickbacks are a form of corruption, also defined as an abuse of one's position of power. Embezzlement. One of the most common occupational frauds is the manipulation of accounting records to steal business funds. Financially astute employees may be able to devise sophisticated schemes to cover their theft. This is called misrepresentation, one of the characteristics of fraud. Misuse of business time. Employees who perform non-work-related functions while at work are committing fraud because they are depriving the business of employee productivity during that time. The act of fraud itself is also included in this category. Alternatively, running a personal business from the employment office constitutes theft of time, as does the time occupied by committing fraudulent activity. Computer fraud. The advent of modern technology has provided more opportunities for employees to commit computer or electronic fraud, facilitating the electronic manipulation of business funds so as to deposit them into personal or other third-party accounts. Not only do computers facilitate the fraudster's activities, but they are also essential in fraud detection. Stock and equipment pilferage. The theft of stock and capital equipment, such as laptop computers, furniture, printers, and so on. Expense abuse. Disguising personal expenses as business expenses in order to steal funds. A myriad of fraud schemes. Within the three types or classifications of corruption, asset misappropriation, and fraudulent financial statements, the list of occupational fraud types, schemes, and methodologies is endless and includes the following. Theft. The intent to permanently deprive another, usually of either assets or money. Procurement fraud. Stealing items purchased or the funds intended to pay for those purchases and covering the theft by false accounting entries. Bribery. Offering or requesting, paying or receiving anything of value with the intent to influence actions, inactions, opinions, or decisions, usually paid up front. Corruption. The abuse of a position of power to gain an advantage. Embezzlement. When a person entrusted with safeguarding an organization's money or property misappropriates it for his or her own benefit. Computer sabotage. Using a computer virus or some other highly technical method to incapacitate the business's computer system with a view to extortion. Counterfeiting. The copying or imitating of an item or document without due authority and passing the copy off as being an original. Forgery. An unauthorized change to a real or original document, which is then used to deceive in order to obtain an advantage. Credit card fraud. The unauthorized use of a credit card to obtain value and personal gain. Extortion. Illegally obtaining property from another by actual or threatened force, fear, or violence. Financial statement fraud. Reporting incorrect results or facts in the financial statements in order to deceive the reader and user. Such fraud can be committed by omission. Insider trading. Using inside, confidential, or advance information to trade in shares and obtain an advantage. Intellectual property theft. The theft and sale of cutting-edge technology by employees from their employers. Kickback. Paying an employee a portion of an inflated purchase price as a reward for facilitating the deal, usually after the event. Bank fraud. Engaging in activity where fraudulent transactions go through a bank. Money laundering. the movement of the proceeds of crime to disguise the illegal source. It is usual, and perhaps a good time now to note, that the counterfeiting and forgery methodologies are quite often those used to hide the misrepresentation implicit in the fraud act itself and are fundamental to most forms of organizational fraud and corruption. Cybercrime. Cybercrime warrants a separate discussion as a methodology or fraud type, as it has specific advantages to the fraudster and corresponding challenges to the investigator, enabling the fraudster to effectively remain anonymous, thereby camouflaging his profile. The threat of cybercrime is growing, according to the Association of Chartered Certified Accountants' February 2012 edition of Accounting and Business International magazine. Cybercrime is now ranked as one of the top four economic crimes, after asset misappropriation, accounting fraud, and bribery and corruption, according to PricewaterhouseCoopers, PwC, Global Economic Crime Survey 2011. Of the 3,877 respondents polled in 78 countries, almost half, 48%, thought the risk of cybercrime was on the rise, with only 4% believing it was falling. Worryingly, stated PwC, 4 in 10 respondents said that their organization didn't have the capability to prevent and detect cybercrime. The Internet as a mask. Cybercrime refers to any criminal activity involving the use of a computer and a network, in particular, the Internet. The computer itself can be used directly in the commissioning of a crime, or it may be the target of the crime. The main difference between fraud in the physical world and Internet fraud is that with available data, cybercriminals can commit crime at a much faster rate than conventional fraudsters, plus have the added advantage of anonymity. Unlike conventional fraudsters, Internet criminals run no risk of being apprehended in store. This level of anonymity makes attempting and successfully conducting Internet crime far easier. It also makes dealing with Internet criminals a daunting prospect. Cybercrime, or computer-based fraud, is the use of any dishonest misrepresentation with the intent of obtaining a benefit by deception and can be carried out by the unauthorized entry of false data, altering of data before entry, altering, destroying, suppressing, or stealing output, altering or deleting stored data, altering or misusing system tools or software packages, and altering or writing code for fraudulent purposes. Cybercrime can range from downloading illegal music files to stealing millions of dollars from online bank accounts, and also includes non-monetary crimes, such as creating and distributing viruses or posting confidential or sensitive information on the Internet. Perhaps the most prominent and largest form of cybercrime is identity theft, in which criminals use the Internet to steal personal information from other users to use to perpetrate frauds for their own advantage. Two of the most common methods of stealing personal information are phishing and farming. Both of these methods lure users to fake or spoof websites that appear to be legitimate, where they are asked to enter personal information, including login information such as usernames and passwords, phone numbers, addresses, credit card numbers, bank account numbers, and other information criminals can use to steal another person's identity. This personal information can then be used in a variety of Internet-based scams targeting consumers directly. To compound the problem of Internet fraud, there are a number of opportunities that Internet-based criminals can take advantage of. For example, immediate credit has become a practical necessity for e-traders wanting to maximize web-based transactions. The result, in many cases, is that the Internet merchant makes instant credit available to online shoppers. This provides criminals with the chance to pose as a legitimate customer, obtain credit, and purchase goods online. Online banks and e-traders need to be constantly vigilant and take steps to protect themselves and their customers against this danger. Typically, online customers are requested to provide personal details before an Internet transaction can be processed. This might include information as to their name, postal address, credit card number, email address, and the product or service being ordered. As has been the experience with online banks, this is an area where web merchants can begin to combat fraud. Asking for extensive personal details helps to determine the legitimacy of an application or online order. In some cases, the person concerned should be the only one knowing the required details, and with this information provided, merchants can then build up a bigger picture of the customer. Ideally, this assessment process should be overlaid with information as to the applicant's past online activity, for example, sites last visited. Closer inspection and analysis of the data collected on application forms can provide insight into fraudulent behavior. Often, the first pattern to emerge comes from an analysis of the credit card type and card number. A strong positive correlation exists between the credit card type section on an application form being left blank and the probability of attempted fraud. Another example is where the credit card type and the credit card number do not correspond. This discrepancy can be ascertained from the credit card number, the bank identification number, BIN, being the first part of the credit card number used to identify the bank issuing the card. Where the BIN is illogical, this may be an indication that the applicant is attempting to guess the correct card type. Obviously, where the card type and card BIN concur, detecting potential fraud becomes harder. In the latter example, the credit grantor would need to examine additional criteria for inconsistencies. Interaction between call center staff and applicants offers a number of advantages. Call center staff can further review applicants and prevent frauds slipping through. With known and valued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.